You have suffered, I know this. You have come to the Abyss, and almost surrendered yourselves to it. That changes now. I am Father, General, Lord, and Mentor. I shall teach you, if I can, and pass on the knowledge I have gained. Honor, self-sacrifice, self-reliance, brotherhood. It is the Promethean Creed, and all must adhere to it if we are to prosper. Let this be the first lesson.
The loyal Primarchs of his Imperium symbolize the pinnacle of humanity, imbuing their legions and the subjects of their homeworlds with their most cherished traits. Honor, valor, sacrifice, duty, and loyalty. Though of all the Primarchs of his Imperium, only one symbolizes the virtue of empathy. A Primarch whom would cherish the subjects of his Imperium. Despite enduring great suffering, he would endeavor to protect his Imperium and his beloved sons. Primarch of the 18th Legion of Adeptus Astartes, Vulkan. With the scattering of the Primarchs, Vulkan's capsule would land on the planet of Nocturne within the settlement of Hesiod. Discovered by a local blacksmith, Labelle, he would name the child Vulkan after the namesake of the first king of the Salamanders, which roamed the volcanic wastes of Nocturne. Within the span of 3 years, Vulkan would outgrow the stature of all the local peoples. Combining his quick cognitive prowess with the teachings of his father, Vulkan would become a famed blacksmith, renowned throughout the planet. Soon he would impart his knowledge of the forge, inventing and discovering new techniques unknown to Nocturne's populace. Yet Nocturne would be plagued by raiding parties led by the Dark Eldar. So common were the Drukhari raids that every person of the town had picked out a space to hide to avoid capture. On the 4th year of Vulkan's arrival to Nocturne, a raid would begin. The young Primarch would refuse to hide. Standing at the center of the settlement, he would wait. A large forge hammer in each hand, he would face his despicable foes, alone. Watching this inspiring gesture, the townspeople would stand by Vulcan's side and prepare to defend their home. The Drukhari would be routed decisively by the wrath of Vulkan, felling over 100 Drukhari by his own hand. Hearing of this great victory, the settlement elders of the 7 largest towns of Nocturne would converge to meet with Vulkan and join him in their fight against the raiders. To celebrate his victory, the people of Nocturne would hold a tournament, which a particular stranger to the planet would attend. Adorned in peculiar clothing and pale of complexion, in contrast to the native Nocturne populace, the stranger would ask to be granted a chance to compete in the tournament, claiming that he could best any challenger. The people of Nocturne laughed in his face as Vulkan accepted the stranger's terms, wagering that the loser of the tournament would serve the victor's whim without question. For 8 days, the contest would endure. Each challenger tested on feats of strength and endurance, such as the anvil lift, wherein the competitors held an anvil above their heads for half a day. With the dawn of the 8th day, the challengers' scores would be tied. To decide a winner, the 2 challengers would be given 24 hours to craft a weapon and hunt the apex predator of Nocturne, the Salamander. The victor would be decided by the size of the salamander with which they had slain. The 2 men would scale a large mountain and split paths. Vulkan would quickly find a massive fire drake and slay it. Carrying his prize over his shoulder, he would descend the mountain. Yet as a twist of fate, the dormant mountain would erupt and cast Vulkan over the side of a cliff. Hanging from the precipice with 1 hand, the Primarch would not release his prize, but be unable to pull himself to safety. Hours passed, and Vulcan's strength began to wane, until he would be found by the stranger. The stranger hefted over his shoulder a salamander, far larger than Vulcan's. Seeing Vulkan in distress, the stranger would cast his prize aside, tossing the salamander into a river of lava, its body acting as a bridge to enable him to reach the Primarch. Hoisting Vulkan away from the precipice, the stranger would aid him in walking back to the town, his superior prize now melting on the molten rock. Returning to the people empty-handed, the stranger would lose the tournament, with Vulkan declared the winner. Yet to the surprise of his people, Vulkan would bend his knee to the strange man, and pledge his life. The stranger, casting off his disguise, revealed his identity as the Emperor of Mankind, now reunited with his long-lost son. Unlike many of his brother Primarchs, Vulkan would not immediately be given command of his legion. For years he would be tutored by the Emperor and fight at his side, unifying with his sons during their battle against a massive orc horde, joining his sons' beleaguered forces, commanding a fleet of 3,000 new recruits he had brought to the fray. The legion's name would be changed from the Dragon Warriors to the Salamanders, honoring the bond forged between the Emperor and Vulkan during their tournament on Nocturne. Vulkan's command of his legion would stand in stark contrast with other Primarchs, the first signs of which involving the 18th Legion's cooperative campaign on the world of Karatan, alongside the Night Lord's Legion and their Primarch, Conrad Kurz. Disgusted with the means that the 8th Legion used to wage war, Vulkan became enraged when the Night Lord slaughtered an entire city in order to root fear within the planet's populace. Vulkan would continually be scarred by the ravages of war, the planet of Karatan being inhabited by humans coexisting with Eldar Exodites, rejecting the intervention of the Imperium's forces. Vulkan surmised that the humans of Karatan would never turn from their Exodite liberators and would never accept the compliance of the Imperium. Combined with the death of his personal Remembrancer, Seraph, he would become enraged, leading to the death of an innocent Eldar child. Racked with guilt, Vulkan would nonetheless order the planet to be cleansed of life, knowing that the human Eldar coexistence that flourished would never be compatible with the Imperium and its creed. Vulkan's misfortune would continue to grow with his legion's intervention during the Istvaan 5 dropsite massacre, a full-scale assault of 9 legions sent to quash Horus Lupercal's fledgling rebellion. Commanded by Ferus Manus of the Iron Hands, Vulkan and Corvus Corax of the Raven Guard would aid the 10th Legion in the initial assault. Against the combined traitor forces of the Emperor's Children, World Eaters, Death Guard, and Sons of Horus. The battle waged, the three loyalist legions holding their ground until the arrival of their inbound allies of the Iron Warriors, Night Lords, Word Bearers, and Alpha Legion. The second wave of legions would turn on their brothers, decimating the three loyalist legions in their ensuing battle. Vulkan's forces would be targeted by the Iron Warriors Legion, firing nuclear missiles into the midst of the Salamander forces, targeting their Primarch. With the fallout subsiding and the battle over, Vulkan would awaken from the blast, his flesh healing itself amongst the ashes of his fallen sons. Vulkan was evidently a perpetual, a being almost incapable of dying. Surrounded by hundreds of legionaries of the Iron Warriors and Night Lords, Vulkan would be stabbed, shot, bludgeoned, and eventually beaten unconscious. Conrad Kurz, Primarch of the Night Lords, would relish the opportunity to torment his brother. For months, Vulkan would be tortured by the Night Haunter, dying over and over again. His head cut from his neck, his throat ripped out, his limbs torn from his body and riddled with bolter fire. He would be jettisoned into space and left within the venting shaft of a starship engine. However, Vulkan would rise from death every time. Growing bored of the torture, Kurz would utilize the powers of the priests of Davin. They would conjure scenarios within Vulcan's mind. He would face trials destined to fail and watch as the illusory innocents' lives at stake would perish. Yet Vulcan's mind would not break. Tiring of his brother's resilience, Kurz would imprison Vulkan within a maze constructed by the Primarch of the Iron Warriors, Perturabo. At its center lay Dawnbringer, the personal weapon of Vulkan, surrounded by the dead sons of his legion, a tempting prize in a futile game. However, after many attempts, Vulkan would reach Dawnbringer and overpower Kurz. Using the teleporter device installed within his Warhammer, Vulkan would escape, teleporting to the Ultramar system in the upper atmosphere of Macragge. There Vulkan would burn during re-entry to the planet's surface, knowing he would revive again under the care of the 13th Legion, the Ultramarines. The Ultramarines would discover Vulcan's charred body, and within days the flesh and bone that remained would regenerate. Summoning their Primarch, Rabute Gilliman, as Vulkan awoke, the Ultramarines would see Vulkan exhibiting signs of mania, incoherence, and mental trauma. Vulcan's time with the Night Haunter had made him sensitive to Kurz's presence, and Vulkan knew that his tormentor was near. Conrad Kurz would break from the confinement of Lionel Johnson's vessel, the Invincible Reason, and wreak havoc throughout McCrag. Vulkan would escape from his cell and pillage Gilliman's personal armory, setting out to confront the Night Haunter. As the two Primarchs battled, the perpetual human, John Grammaticus, would arrive on McCrag. Armed with the Fulgrite, a concentrated spear tip of pure energy unleashed by the Emperor, Grammaticus would stab Vulkan through the heart, unleashing a massive psychic explosion, killing them both within the blast radius. Vulcan's corpse would be interred within a stasis field, handcrafted by Rabute Gilliman. The remaining Salamanders on McCrag would guard their Primarch's body and bring it to the summit of Mount Deathfire on their homeworld of Nocturne. Artellus Numian, Vulcan's loyal son and first captain of the Firedrakes, would sacrifice his life unto the magma core of the mountain, allowing Vulkan to awaken. His mind and sanity restored by the Fulgrite infused with the Emperor's power. Enthralled by a vision, Vulkan would be led to two artifacts he had previously created, but had no recollection of crafting. One such artifact being the Talisman of Seven Hammers. Using the talisman, Vulkan would travel through the webway, and after many trials, eventually reach Holy Terra. On Terra, Vulkan would be led by the Adeptus Custodes to his father, the Emperor. Trapped upon the Golden Throne, the Emperor would reveal that he had led his loyal son to his side throughout his journey, revealing that the Talisman of Seven Hammers had been created as a contingency to destroy Holy Terra should the traitor forces of Chaos succeed in defeating the Imperium, entrusting its creation to Vulkan as the only son whom would hesitate to use it due to the incredible loss of life that it would cause. Vulkan installed the talisman under the Golden Throne and would defend his father in secret during the Siege of Terra. Soon thereafter, Magnus the Red and a group of his thousand sons would infiltrate the Imperial dungeon to confront the Emperor. Vulkan would block their path, protecting his father from a lethal attack from Magnus's staff. The Emperor and Vulkan would bid the Crimson King to return to the Path of Righteousness, but their offer would be refused. Vulkan and Magnus would duel. Saved from a fatal blow by Salamander Legionnaire Igen Gargo, Vulkan would wield his fallen son's Warhammer in one hand and Dawnbringer in the other, using them to pummel Magnus into submission. In desperation, Magnus would call unto the dark powers of Chaos, fully surrendering his soul to the fell powers and retreating into the warp. With the Siege of Terra over and his father wounded during his duel with Horus, Vulkan would leave his Salamander's legion and venture into the far reaches of space, vowing alike to his brother Primarch Leman Russ to one day return to his legion in their darkest hour. Over a millennia and a half later, Vulkan would engage the Orc hordes during the War of the Beast. Alone, he would defend the world of Caldera from the Orc invasion, dying over and over again, yet reviving and facing his foes with relentless ferocity. Crafting the Warhammer Doom Tremor, Vulkan would rally the Imperium's forces, leading the counterattack against the mighty Orc war boss, the Beast, on the planet of Ulanor. Vulkan would face the Beast, tackling the war boss into a large power generator, absorbing the Orc energy within, known as War. Vulkan would unleash its raw power through Doom Tremor, ending the War of the Beast and obliterating himself and the war boss. In the years since his passing, no trace has been recovered of Vulkan, his legion maintaining that he shall one day uphold his promise when all 9 artifacts of Vulkan have been gathered. Their Primarch shall return.
Ours is a violent calling, but as adherents of the Promethean Creed, we believe in the Circle of Fire. None can come back as they once were, but in death we are returned to the ash from whence we came to be born anew. Our blood and bone bonded with the earth. Through fire are our remains made protean. Through fire and their union with earth, do we experience rebirth. After death, after our duty is ended, we give ourselves to these elements, and in doing so, become part of them. This is the nature of the Circle of Fire.
This has been a tale of the great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Sons of Deliverance, sharpen your claws, for in my next and final transmission of Primarch, I shall extol the deeds of Primarch Corvus Corax.